Like so many topics we examine in this course, labor or work also tends to follow the pattern of having strong similarities across North America, while at the same time differing somewhat to reflect the more local circumstances and legacies of particular parts of the continent. We'll begin this part of the lecture then with some of those historical realities or legacies. Remember from our first lecture on colonization that the density of the indigenous population in New Spain was very high relative to other parts of North America. This population became an important and concentrated pool of labor for the colonizers. Their empire was developed using this indigenous labor, and in fact, there was something of a precedent for this already. The Aztec Empire had also very effectively used laborers for its economic development. Earlier in the course, we talked about the encomienda system. Remember, this was essentially a system that allowed the Spaniards to force the indigenous peoples to provide labor as a form of tribute. Given the density of indigenous peoples, the system worked reasonably well for the colonizers, who were aspiring to accumulate wealth or capital. That is, it worked well until the indigenous population declined and the Spanish population increased, just as demand for even more labor also increased. In Mexico, the encomienda was eventually replaced by the repartimiento. Under this system, a percentage of male residents in any given village were required to provide labor for several weeks a year in the cities, farms, and mines. Alongside these more formal labor structures in Mexico, there were also less formal but more common practices. The most important involved rural laborers known as peones. The peones entered into a contractual relationship with an employer, where wages were advanced to the workers, who then got caught in a cycle of indebtedness. Sounds a bit like modern-day payday loans. In the case of the peones, the indebtedness could even be passed on from one generation to the next. It's important also to recognize the variations that occurred in Mexico. Even amongst rural laborers, those in the north, where laborers were more scarce, had greater bargaining power than their counterparts in the south, where there was simply more laborers to take jobs. And in urban areas, and remember that southern North America was far more urbanized in the colonial period than was true in the north, there was tremendous diversity in labor. Highly specialized trades had been common even before the conquest, and the arrival of Spaniards simply added more diversity, with trades such as tailors, coopers, hatters, and silversmiths. One trend was clear, though, even amongst these urban workers. Occupations were often associated with status in society, and race had a tendency to ensure that certain hierarchies were created, with indigenous peoples, blacks, and mestizos, filling occupations considered to be inferior. In the north, the French colonies were much less diverse in terms of labor. Here, the fur trade, forestry, and fishing were particularly important. We've talked about the coureurs de bois, who were central to the fur trade. By the 18th century, people spoke more about the voyageur, a term that came to be used to refer to those directly trading with the Aboriginal peoples and the merchants who received the furs and developed wealth from them. As settlement took hold in New France, agricultural labor was also important. The farmers, known as habitants, gradually earned control over their lands while providing a given percentage of their crops to the seigneur, a sort of feudal lord in the community. In addition to providing a percentage of their crops, the habitants also provided labor in a system that was called the corvée. The labor was typically used to build infrastructure for the community at large, roads or bridges, for example. In a sense, it's a bit like the repartimiento in Mexico, but much less labor was involved, and the corvée did not have the same social stigma attached to it. Finally, as noted in the previous lecture, slaves and indentured servants also lived in New France and provided labor for economic development, but they were much less important in economic terms than was the case further south. Settlement in what would become the United States introduced an important difference in terms of labor. The original colonizers here arrived as shareholders in the companies that brought them. As a consequence, they were able to acquire rights to land and profit from it more directly and quickly. These colonies then gained a reputation for being composed of small, independent freeholders who worked to better themselves and their families. Of course, in the American colonies, there were also those who worked as indentured servants and slaves. The indentured laborers traveled from Europe and agreed to work for employers for several years to pay back the cost of their passage. Slavery may have started modestly in the American colonies, but by the 1850s, 60% of the world's supply of cotton was being grown in the American South. The plantation owners there could accumulate considerable wealth and use this power to influence political developments, all on the back of forced slave labor. Agriculture, then, was critical to the early economic development of North America, and the nature of work or labor was very much shaped by this economic activity. By the late 1800s, though, the North American economy was experiencing a transformation. Industrialization began to take hold, particularly in the northeast to midwest of the United States. In this part of the continent, all the ingredients necessary for the recipe of economic success were present. Lots of natural resources, including coal, good transportation along rivers, canals, and railroads, technology that lowered costs of production, abundant labor thanks to millions of immigrants, and clever business owners and capitalists who would soon accumulate wealth to a degree hardly imagined possible previously. Soon, mom-and-pop, family-oriented businesses were overshadowed by the emergence of giant corporate entities. Increasingly, workers no longer had close connections and personal relationships with their employers. The majority of people essentially became part of a large working class, and industrial capitalism, as this trend is often labeled, demanded long, hard, and often unsafe work from men, women, and even children. Work weeks of 60 or 72 hours were not uncommon. Confronted by such difficult conditions, workers began to organize to fight for their rights. Here we can see the early beginnings of the root of labor activism that Dolores Huerta would take up in the 1960s. By the late 1800s and early 1900s, various organizations and unions emerged advocating for workers' rights. Some of these organizations, such as the Industrial Workers of the World, had radical ambitions to overthrow the capitalist system and restructure society. Ultimately, the much less radical American Federation of Labor became a leading labor institution in the U.S. Its leader, Samuel Gompers, wanted to get more from the work-labor system. He did not imagine fundamentally altering it. As labor organized and exercised greater power, conflict with industry became more common. Strikes, the very sort of activity Dolores Huerta and Cesar Chavez would use to such good effect decades later, became the key weapon labor could wield in its attempt to achieve change. Some strikes in this early era were infamous for their levels of violence. The Haymarket Square strike in Chicago and the Homestead strike outside Pittsburgh are good examples of just how violent things could get. In Canada, organized labor evolved along lines very similar to the U.S. The Trades and Labor Congress of Canada had formed by 1883 and played a role similar to the American Federation of Labor. Generally, the Canadian labor movement was characterized by less radicalism and less violence than had been seen in the U.S. That said, the Industrial Workers of the World was also present in Canada, and at times workers did unite in serious confrontations. The Winnipeg General Strike of 1919 is perhaps the best example. The entire city came to a standstill, and the protest was only brought to an end when the Northwest Mounted Police were dispatched to end it violently. In Mexico, labor faced challenges in effectively organizing the way it had in Canada and the U.S. Industrialization had been slower in Mexico. From 1884 to 1911, Mexico was ruled by Porfirio Diaz, who was the country's president, but he was also something of a dictator. He was very much allied with the capitalist class, both those in Mexico and foreign capitalists who had invested in the country. When workers attempted to organize, their efforts were often stopped by hired thugs and intervention by government troops, for example. When Mexican miners in northern Sonora went on strike for wages comparable to those earned by U.S. citizens working in the same mine, they were gunned down by forces brought in by the governor of Sonora. It would really take until the early 20th century before labor was able to play any important role in Mexican politics. President Lázaro Cárdenas came to power in 1934 and his administration is seen as having been very friendly towards labor. Almost half a century after comparable organizations had emerged in Canada and the U.S., in 1936, the Confederation of Mexican Workers was formed. The Union and Cardenas supported one another. The president also supported the establishment of the National Confederation of Farm Workers. He was seen as a patron of the campesinos, or rural farmers, and advocated for the redistribution of land so that individual farmers would have control over the plots of land they worked, even when the land was held communally. From this part of the lecture, I hope you can see how labor emerged as an important aspect of life in North America. In all three countries, workers eventually united to actively organize to improve their living and working conditions, though the timing and level of violence inherent in this organization varied across the continent. Labor faces many challenges today in North America. The reality is that a small percentage of the population controls an increasingly large percentage of the total wealth. Inequality in all three North American nations is increasing. Later in the course, we'll address international trade. Increased international and continental trade is sometimes touted as the solution to lowering unemployment and generating greater wealth across society. Yet, as we'll see when we get to that topic in the course, there are difficulties with that assumption too. That's it for now. We'll see you in part 3.